You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast finds you extraordinarily well. We are in the later half of our story slate for November 2018, issue 146. Thank you for joining us thus far. This is our fifth story, and it is titled The Love Letters, and is by Peng Simeng, and is translated by S. Qiouyi Lu. Peng Simeng is a science fiction writer who used to work as a product manager in Tencent, the biggest internet company in China. A themed collection of her works has appeared in one of China's top SF magazines, Science Fiction World. Her novella, Beast Boxing, won an honorable award in the 2017 Duban Reading Writing Competition. She is currently studying the Creative Writing Master Program at Beijing Normal University. And, like everything else, this story is brought to you by your support. Our partnership with Storycom in China, all of our translated works, they're because of you. So please, go to clarksworldmagazine.com/donate to see how you can be a part of something special and diverse. I invite you to sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. People say that when the Creator made all, everything was given a purpose. But asteroid I-12152-52512-1 seemed to have been left out of that grand plan. This asteroid resided between two prosperous galaxies, but it had never been established as a starport like its neighbors. It had only one stone and no ore, only sub-zero chill and no atmosphere, only howling gales and no birdsong. Even if a cutthroat interstellar merchant fleet scanned the asteroid's identification number, they would be loath to send even an exploratory probe to the asteroid's surface. Swept along by the endlessly turbulent sandstorms on this worthless asteroid were countless capsules. These capsules were the asteroid's only remarkable feature. In fact, they were the cause of many people's misfortunes. In the commonly used interstellar positioning system, the coordinates for asteroid I-12152-52512-1 were just one numeral off from those for humanity's old home planet. In the era where people had to manually enter coordinates, countless spaceships sent precious interstellar message capsules cascading to the barren lands of the asteroid below. The messages in these lead capsules were supposed to travel through space and reach the eager hands of their hopeful recipients, but instead they languish in this information graveyard. They dance and stop and dance, until one day, when time itself is in ruins, they too will stand still. Among these countless capsules are four that endlessly flutter and rest, the messages saved in their titanium-encrusted cores below. Dearest Persephone, I feel I must write you this letter. You won't believe it. Right now, a magnificent red giant is flitting past the hull of my spaceship, washing the command room in a cozy blush. The various instruments cast twinkling shadows on the ground, where I lie looking up at the ceiling. If you were beside me, you would surely fall in love with the sights outside, yet even the present me still appreciates this moment, for it reminds me of the sunset on the day I left home. That day, you rained kisses on me so softly. They still fall every time I enter my dreams. I've already been on the solo mission for 142 days now, dearest. I'm not always this weak and needy. I've already landed on 16 constellations in succession, explored every planet that could possibly hold crystal, stone, or ore, but I've only found disappointment. At every free starport, countless captains who have already been through this cycle of disappointment would seize my ear and drag me from the pub while bellowing, "The minerals have all been stripped bare. No one will ever find another planet rich with high-grade ore." But I would also meet some eccentrics like me, people still sailing interplanetary ships to the most remote corners of the universe. hope twinkles in their eyes. They would share their trade secrets with me, routes and tricks for success, and I took them all to heart. With the hope that those captains gave me, I was always able to track down some kind of lead. In a previous galaxy, I even found a massive, undeveloped vein of ore for the first time. With only 2 million more years, it would be fully formed. Oh, it truly was such a pity. Still, this at least showed me that my search method was effective. I felt that surely I was going to strike it big and find a planet rich with ore soon. Then, I could modestly slip back home with a ship full of gold bits. Oh, dearest, you don't need to worry. When that time comes, I won't be arrogant and shallow like others who find their fortune and become new money. They make me want to vomit. Although I may be empty-handed now, this beautiful, boundless universe captivates me and soothes my restless heart. I've always wanted to roam the open seas of the universe, even before birth. You can imagine how much more excited I am to be here searching for precious minerals. Of course, fate sometimes watches out for me. I narrowly missed an ion storm, and I haven't encountered anything else as dangerous that would sink my ship. So please don't worry about me. I'm becoming more and more familiar with my ship. With every day that passes, we are closer to becoming one. I'm also beginning to have a better understanding of this ocean of stars. I wish you were by my side to see these magnificent celestial bodies. They make you feel infinitesimally small, and yet inspire your infinitesimal smallness, too. Dearest, I will most certainly bring back a ship full of treasures. I know I have no right to make you wait like this, of course. At the last free port, I ran into one of our mutual friends, Heliconia. He said that you were still waiting for me. Oh, I felt so moved and grateful. Lisa and Kiriku are resting in the deposit cabin. I hope they don't discover that their captain is lamenting his anguish on the control cabin floor, or else they'll ridicule me. They truly do love to ridicule people, those two. Tomorrow I'll set sail toward the Bok galaxy. I hope I can strike it rich there. Dearest, wish me luck. Missing you. Hushan, November 6th, 2802. Dearest Persephone, I don't know what time it will be when you receive this letter. Will it be during dawn, sunset, or a meteor shower? Wherever you receive this letter, please trust that I am thinking deeply of you. I just left the Bok galaxy where I ran into a bit of luck. Guess what? I found a vein of ore. At the time, I thought I could leave right then to be by your side. We shipped ore to the nearest free port, but those damned graders said that the ore was of a mediocre quality. We immediately registered the planet, sold off the mining rights, and got some cash for them, but honestly, it wasn't much. Faced with a tiny number in my bank account, what should I do? Should I split the cash with Lisa and Kiriku, sell off the ship, then rush back to your arms? No, I can't do that. I don't dare to say that I've never thought of doing such a thing. Our jade green lake and little boat, the little wooden boat we'd paddle on together, keeps appearing in my dreams. My adventures in the universe have me even more convinced that I won't be drifting for much longer. There's got to be a day where I can return home to go boating with you on that jade green lake. That will be my final resting place. But I can't return home like this. At least not now. I'm convinced that my ore-finding method is foolproof now. I just need to patiently wait for Lady Luck's favor. Believe me, I will return to your arms and recount the tales of my adventures, but not now. Definitely not now. If I were to return now, I would only seclude myself on the lake, sighing all day with the weight of my melancholy heart. After I issue an order to continue searching for ore, I restocked our supplies and patched up the spaceship. We're currently en route to the Berlioz galaxy. Dearest, will you forgive my selfishness? Hushan, May 2nd, 2803. Dearest Persephone, the Berlioz galaxy is hell, but I'm still alive. Squalls, yellow sand, knife-like sunlight. If I hadn't turned the protection on my eye gear up to the maximum strength, I wouldn't have been able to open my eyes at all. Every night, I would have to bury the spaceship with sand to hide from the thunderstorms, then set sail amidst mud-like acid rain at daybreak. The people here weren't exactly welcoming. They were insects nearly as large as me. They charged my spaceship in columns, their sawtooth-like teeth gnawing ka-ka-ka-ka on the outside of the spaceship, leaving a series of holes in their wake. The insects chased us from one planet to another, that gnawing sound penetrating into my dreams, disturbing me from my boat on the lake. But the most terrifying sound wasn't the one from outside. Rather, it was the endless arguing from inside the spaceship. I insisted on combing all 10 planets of the Berlioz galaxy, but as the results sank us deeper into despair, my plan caused my crew to lose hope. But this kind of foolish plan is the only way to ensure that we won't miss any ore. Am I in the wrong? Lisa left in the end. She didn't believe that we could continue. She didn't part on good terms, and we didn't even wish her farewell. If you see her, please take her by the hand and tell her in that warm way of yours that I don't resent her for it anymore. In fact, I'm grateful for the time she spent with us on our expeditions. I'm thinking that with your way with words, surely she'll understand. Kiriku is still with me. His courage and persistence exceeded my expectations. We're preparing to go to the dark corner of the Maher Galaxy to try our luck. That's the place with the highest rate of ore formation. Why haven't we been there yet? Were we concerned about the massive underwater monsters? But what could be worse than the insects from the Berlioz Galaxy? These days, I often forget what you look like. So I look at pictures of you, staring at each of them in turn. Memory is a strange thing. Your likeness is hazy, but I always recall the warmth of your kiss, the softness of your hands, the enchanting scent of your rose perfume. These are all marked in my memory, still unfading. I think it won't be long until we meet again. Please, for one last time, wait a little longer for me. Hushan. October 6th, 2804. Fenny, Fenny. There's water everywhere. The aft is split open. Something keeps battering the hull. Our fate has been sealed. Kiriku has already stopped breathing. I'm so grateful for his faith in me. He supported me from the beginning to the end, right until the very last moment. He supported having an android like me as captain, but I failed to live up to his expectations. I've decided my body will stay here with him in eternal rest. Do you regret falling in love with an android? Did I fail to live up to your love, too? Oh, dearest, I only have a little time left. I must transfer the backup of my consciousness kernel into a lead capsule. Please put it into a new body. When you open this letter, I will have returned. I love you. Hushan. December 16th, 2832. The above are the full contents of the metal cores. They are sealed perfectly intact inside those four capsules, chasing each other through vicious storms in their lonely dance, through the silent darkness, through endless gales. These four capsules tumble with hundreds of thousands of others swirling through air thick with capsules. No one knows about them, and no one will know what is written in them, what is hidden. They are carried by the long river of time. When, after the last person who can decipher these contents has died, only the grim rays of the universe will occasionally shine on these capsules, illuminating each tiny scratch on their titanium surfaces. Until the river of time carries them to the very end. This story was originally published in Chinese in Science Fiction World, February 2018. It has been translated and published in partnership with Storycom. I feel so bad for our android friend and his love, Persephone. Stories like this wrench at my heart because it's not only the damage that is left behind, waiting every day for their love to come back, even if it is an android, but we see the other side of this equation, where Hushan has been trying to get back only with the promise of treasures to his love, and will never do so because he is now upon this asteroid floating through space, just one digit off from the postal code that was supposed to be Earth. What are your thoughts on this story? You can leave us a comment or a question at the Clarkesworld Magazine website itself. We've got two more stories left for you for November. I hope you do come back and join us if you so should choose. And until then, bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.